existing trained model, right? So train on some XY is a data set and make a reuse on the some cat or splever fishes data set. And basically, the handcrafted features are, we cannot reuse that same applications for the other. For example, I train on the flower species. I cannot reuse that same feature for the cat or classifications or animal classifications. But in case of deep learning, we can make a reuse of the existing features which was trained on the some data set. So this is a simple representation, pictorial representation, what exactly happening in between the deep learning layers. So it starts from the extraction of edge or corners, and it still it go keep passing the output to the next layer. And the final layer, it start extracting the high-level feature. It may be a shape, or it may be a structural part, or the sub-images of the particular objects. So that goes to the basically, right? But in case of deep learning approaches, it is a completely end-to-end. Each, there will be a multiple layers will be there. So basically, we'll have a set of input and the output layer. And in between input and output, we'll have a set of hidden layers, right? So in case of hidden layer, we'll not be able to define what is the number of neurons. But in case of, we'll be able to define the number of input dimension and the output number of neurons we'll be able to define. For example, I have an image data, which is a 28 cross 28. So what is the number of pixels? There are 784 pixels are there. So the each neurons carries the single input. Okay, so there will be 784 neurons will be there in case of the input layer. So if I go for a multi-classification problem, based on the number of classes, we'll be able to define the number of neurons for the output layer. So in between input and output, we'll have a set of hidden layer 1 and hidden layer 2. So we can keep fine-tuning the number of neurons for the hidden layer. So but we have a control of defining the input dimensions and the output number of neurons based on the what kind of data set you are using. So some of the activation functions we'll be using for creating and deep learning architectures. So basically here I have used sigmoid, tanh, and the ReLU. So for the hidden layer, we'll be using most of the, based on the research paper, most of the hidden layer will be using the ReLU as the activation function. And in case of the output layer, there are two activation functions most of the time we'll be using, sigmoid and softmax. If it is a binary classification problem, we'll be using a sigmoid activation functions at the output layer. If it is a multi-classification problem, we'll go with the softmax activation. So basically, in what happens exactly with the each neuron, basically, it tries to do the dot product between the input neurons and the weight vector. There are two things. One is a feature vector, which is the pixel value or the raw data, and then we'll be randomly initializing the weight vector, which is called as a W vector. So you just assume that there will be n number of input dimension. Each input dimension, you try to do a perspective the respective the weight value, and then you do a dot product, and the summed up value goes to an activation function. So the activation function's results will be assigned to the output neurons, basically. So this is a simple example. When in case of image, we'll be having the color images, or it may be grayscale. So you try to reshape into a 1D vector. So based on the number of pixels, we'll be defining the input dimension vector. So basically, as I said, there are two vectors, the weight value, and the F represent the activation function. The activation function's results will be assigned to the N4. So we'll go in a sequential way. So first from the input to the hidden layer 1, hidden layer 2, and hidden layer 3. So we'll not be doing any computations on the input layer, just pass the connections to the next layer in the network. So in case of here, the first thing what we are trying to do, the hidden layer computation, the N4 and N5, respective weight value and the input connections, and sum up, pass on to the activation, results will be assigned to this particular neuron. Similarly, you try to compute the N5. So once you compute the hidden layer 1, so go to the next layer in the network, which is output layer. So it receives the two input connections, the respective weight value, and do a dot product. Summed up value goes to an activation, and then you will get the predicted value. So we'll be having an actual value, which is a ground truth value, which is a Y, and you take a sum of difference between the predicted value and the actual value, the error will be calculated. Then the error will be backpropagated until the error goes minimal. You keep backpropagating the architectures, basically. So this is a simple way of representation. So we'll be having the 12,287 pixels. So you do a dot product, and then summed up value goes to an activation function. And then finally the sigmoid activation functions, whether it's a binary class, whether it's a cat or not. So the probability value above 0.5, we are considering as a cat. So I'll just take a simple neural network architectures. I just wanted to explain what exactly internally it happens. For the understanding purpose, I have taken the simple architectures, three input neurons connections, and the hidden layer one with the three neurons, and it is a multi-classification problem, two-class problem, two neurons at the output layer. I'm just going to take the sigmoid activation functions for this particular deep learning architectures. And I have taken the random value for the input neuron value, 0.5, 0.9, and minus 0.3. So we'll have an input connection of H1 with 3, H2 with 3, and H3 with 3. So I have assigned a random value for the weight value, and similarly for the O1 and O2. Okay. So there will be a separate weight value for H1, H2, and H3. Okay. So now I'm going to compute what will be the value of H1. So how do I compute? So basically, 0.5, the respective weight value, which is a 1, plus 0.9 into minus 2, plus minus 0.3 into 2. So the respective weight value, you sum up this value, I'll be getting as a minus 1.9. So which goes to an activation function, the result will be the 0.13. The value will be assigned. So basically, there are two vectors. One is an input vector, and other one is a weight vector. So the weight vectors are here, and the input values are here. So you do a dot product, and sum up goes to an activation. So you similarly, you compute the hidden layer remaining neurons value. And then I'll go back to the next layer, which is a output layer, O1 and O2. Okay. So I have a respective weight value. So 0.13 into minus 3 plus 0.96 into minus 3, 1 plus 0.40 into minus 3. So you'll have a summed up value of minus 0.63. So the activation function's value will be assigned over here. Similarly, you compute the O2. Okay. So just to make you to understand what exactly happening in the hidden layer neurons, I've taken the simple neural network architectures and I have given the random value of hidden neurons, input neurons value and the random value for the weight vector. And once you compute this loss value and then you keep changing this weight value and you keep iterating the multiple epochs until the loss goes minimal. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to take a Pima Indian data set, which is a diabetics data set. Whether the person is having a diabetics or not, it's a binary classification problem. So there are 8 features are there. There are 768 sampled records are there. There are 9 columns in this data set. The first 8 columns are input features, and the last variable is an output variable. So I'll be constructing a neural network for this particular data set. So what is our input connections? Input dimensions will be the 8. And here, 2 hidden layer. Hidden layer 1 with the 12 neurons. Hidden layer 2 with the 8 neurons. And it's a binary classification. The output neurons value will be the 1. So I'll go back to the Google Colab. So I have created a repository for this, especially for this particular workshop. So I have created a MLDS2020. My GitHub ID is Mohanraj, MIT is my GitHub ID. So which has the all these IPython notebook files. So I'm going to open the notebook file one by one from my GitHub. So I'm just copying the URL of my GitHub repository. The first one which I want to start with the neural networks Pima under IPython notebook files. So for these hands-ons, I'll be using a Keras as well as the TensorFlow. The backend, I'm using a TensorFlow. So basically, the data sets, everything's are available in my Git. From my Git, I'm trying to clone the data. So I'm importing the necessary libraries. So once I imported the necessary libraries, and I'm trying to clone the data from my Git, which has the CSV file of Pima Indian dataset. So whatever you want to build any neural networks or deep learning in the Colab, the first thing is that you need to push your data into the your local machines or from your Google Drive or either it may be from Git. You have to push your data. So my data is here. From this repository, I have cloned from the Git to the Colab. So here my data set is available. So once I have cloned this repository, I'm going to read the CSV file. The CSV file has the 9 column. So I'm trying to do an array slicing in this case. So first, all the records, all the rows. All the rows and the 0 to 7 columns and the y variable, which is the last column where I'm trying to extract the x and y. So now I'm going for creating a model. So as I said, I'm going to have three layers in this case. Hidden layer 1, hidden layer 2, and hidden layer 3. And one output layer, which is a binary classification problem. And the for the first hidden layer, we have to define what is the input dimension. For the respective the hidden layer, the output of the previous layer will be acting as an input to the next layer. And the activation functions for the hidden layer 1 and hidden layer 2 and hidden layer 3, I'm using a ReLU activation function. And for the output layer, I'll be using a sigmoid activation because of it's a binary classification. And there is a one more parameter, which is the initialization of the weight. Instead of going for a random initialization of weight, we can use some of the distribution where you can quickly get good results. So here I'm using an uniform distribution to initialize the weight vector. So once I create a model, there are three-step process. Once you have to create a model, then the model.compile. So where we have to specify the two things, what kind of loss functions we are using, what is the optimization technique. So there are two things with respect to the loss. In case of image classifications, binary cross entropy and a categorical cross entropy loss. If you are going for a binary classification, use binary cross entropy. If it is a multi classification, go for the categorical cross entropy. Most of them using an optimization as a Adam. Recently, there is a research paper came with the R Adam. You can play around with this different version of Adam. So, which is a basic version is an stochastic gradient descent. So the advanced version, currently most of the people in the community are using with the Adam. So once I compile this model, then you can use the model.summary function to get a tabular representation, how many parameters. Basically, once you plot this table, you'll be able to compute how complexity your architecture is. If your number of parameters are more, because nowadays people are working with 100 million parameters or 5 million parameters or 10 million parameters. So when we deploy these kind of deep learning architectures into a low-spec hardware, the computation complexity will be very high. So when we design on deep learning architectures, you make sure that the number of parameters will be very less. So in this case, the number of parameters are 293. So as I said, the first layer with 12 neurons, and the second layer with 8 neurons, and the third layer with 8 neurons, the last layer with the 1. So you'll get the overall, what will be the output dimensions which we are going to get from the each layer. So the last one where I'm going to do the model training, as I said, first one is the model creation, model compile. The last one is the model.fit function. So where I have to pass a input variable and the output variable, and what is the number of iterations and the batch size, and the last one where you can give the validation data as well. So I have not mentioned the validation data. So you can do a splitting of the whole data into the training and then testing. You can keep some of the ratio of data for the 80% for the training and the 20% for the remaining for the testing. And then once you can validate your model, whether your model is overfit or whether your model is underfitting. So once you identify the model, then you can apply some of the dropout layers in here. Dropout and batch normalization layer, I was talking about the overfitting, which is called as a regularization term, basically. So you can use either dropout or batch normalization to avoid the overfitting or underfitting. Okay. So I'll be discussing in some of the architectures those layer. For this particularly, for the this particular data set, I'm not used splitting of data. I just go with the initial version to the higher one. So I'm running the cells one by one. So that's it. It will go for a training for 200 iterations, and then it will stop. So any doubts on this particular, maybe I'll. If you have any doubts, quickly I can take some questions on this.
Can you explain overfitting and underfitting?
Basically, overfitting, basically when your training data performs well, and if your validation data if not performing well, more accuracy on the, let's assume that you are getting more accuracy on the training data, validation data, you are not getting the better results. So for the known data, you are getting good results. And the unknown data, its model is not performing well. So that is called as an overfitting. Underfitting in the sense, even your training data itself not getting a good results. So that I'll go more detail about what exactly those terms.
What was the criteria of selecting batch size as 50?
See that again, some of the there is a concept called a hyperparameter, mm-hmm. basically. So you, I have given a constant value. You can keep changing that. See, I have not discussed about the hyperparameter. As I said, I'll just give you the what are the hyperparameter we can play around with these deep learning architectures. So the one of the hyperparameters are the number of neurons for the hidden layer. As I said, input dimension we cannot change because my data is a Pima Indian data set, which has the 8 number of features, and the output variable is 1, which is a binary classifications. So I can change this hidden number of neurons, which is a 12, 8, and 8. I can play around with that, and you can measure which, because as I said, there's no proof for what should be the parameter, especially for the hidden layer 1 or hidden layer 2. You can keep play around with those parameter. The next one where you can also play around with the activation functions as well. So why it is a ReLU? Why can't I go for a parametric ReLU or a leaky ReLU? So there are different versions of ReLU as well as available. We can play around with the activation functions as well. And we can also play around with the loss functions as well as the optimization technique. Yeah, that's what, as I said, the best one, as per my research, most of the deep learning architecture which I work and came across, most of the deep learning. So I use Adam where I'm getting a good results. So once you keep working on to the multiple data set and multiple use cases, you will know what parameter has to be used. So that will be, once you work on multiple deep learning architectures, you will be knowing the parameters. Instead of fine tuning it, you will be giving us a constant value.
So, given that these are hyperparameters and we need to try out all parameters, possible parameters, mm-hmm. but given the time constraint, mm-hmm. do you see any solution or any automation process which can minimize our effort on reaching to the best solution on the trying part actually? Mm-hmm. So, this is a proven solution. Mm-hmm. You might have tried for a long period of time, mm-hmm. but how do you minimize that initial time period given mm-hmm. that we have a constraint of delivery? Mm-hmm.
So, that's what there is a concept called a transfer learning, which I'm going to discuss today. So we'll not be learning the entire layer. So instead of learning from the first layer to till last layer, we are going to retrain only the last few layers. So that I'll discuss. Probably you'll be getting my the answers. Yeah, it's see what I'm talking about with respect to image. There are 10 plus pre-trained models are available in Keras API. So ResNet, you can use Inception V3. So there are multiple architectures, VGC16, 19. You can use any of these deep learning architectures if you go for an image classifications. Because it was trained on the ImageNet data, where it has the millions of data which was trained on. So if you train it from the scratch, you will not be able to get those kind of results actually. See, that's what as I said. So there is no. You may get the high results when. In this case, I have used hidden layer neurons with the 12, hidden layer 1, and if I increase into 30, it may improve or it may decrease. So that's what I'm saying. So there is. No, it's basically a black box in case of hidden layer neurons, where we cannot say this is the fixed value for 12. We cannot say that, because we have to keep fine tuning until we get a good results.
So, I have a question.
Maybe I'll pause now. So, I'll take one more example for the same neural network, because I need to cover too many things. Yes, please. Last question, maybe.
Yes,
I'll.
So, right now your hidden layer is fully connected.
Yes, yes.
In this Keras example, suppose if I wish to create a non-fully connected hidden layer, mm-hmm. I want to
That's
capture
what dropout you can. You can use a dropout where all the connections is not required to pass to the next layer in the network. You can remove some of the connections where you can specify the percentage of the connections where you can remove. Is that
but,
your?
Yeah, so but that dropout will be random. Suppose I want.
Yes, yes, that is a random.
But I want the hidden layer.
See, in this case, especially in the neural networks are deep learning, so it's not defined by human. Basically, the machine is trying to find the pattern. You just define how your architecture has to be look like. Then the machine starts finding the unique patterns, basically. So you cannot define anything over here. If you go for an, if you define by human being, then it's in handcrafted features. So the main advantage is that basically with respect to deep learning, learning a feature by the machine itself. So I'm going to take one more data set for the neural network, which is an animals data set, which has the three classes. So in this case, the data set which I'm using an animals data set, where it has the three classes. One is a cat, dog, and pandas. So cat I'm considering as a 0, dog I'm considering as a 1, and the pandas I'm considering as a class label as a 3. So in this case, when you go for an any open source data, each images will have a different dimensions, right? So when because we are not going to define a dynamic range of deep learning architectures, because we are saying an input dimension as a constants, right? So if I say 8, for all the sample data, the input dimension has to be 8, right? So there may be a possibility each images will have a different dimensions. So in that case, where I'm trying to resize my images into a constant size, in this case, there are 3,000 samples are there for each category of 1,000 sample for each category. So there are 3,000 samples. I'm trying to resize all the samples using an OpenCV library. And then I have appended into a list variable all the image sample. And the output variables are stored in the label list. So as I said, if you flatten the 32 cross 32 into 3, as a, if it is a color images, there will be three matrices will be there, a red matrix, green matrix, and blue matrix, each matrix of 32 cross 32. If you flatten that into one dimensional, it will be a 3072 pixel values will be there. So my size of the input data will be the 3,000 rows, 3,000 records, and the number of features or the number of input pixel value will be the 3072. So the output variable, which is a 3,000 with one columns. So in this case, there is a one more concept, which is a normalization. If it is an image, the pixel values are lies between 0 to 255. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to apply image normalization, where I'm going to divide the maximum pixel value divided by the each pixels. So where all the pixel, instead of 0 to 255, all the pixel value will be normalized into 0 to 1. So once I'm done with the normalization, I'm going for an one-hot encoding, basically to convert the all these class labels into a 2D binary representation. In my case, the number of classes is 3, which is a cat, dog, and pandas. So if it is a cat as a class label, I'll be representing 100. The next class, if it is a dog, 010. Then if it is a pandas, it will be 001. So we are converting the all the class labels into a 2D binary representation based on the number of classes. If the number of classes is 3, so for each classes, you need a 3-bit representation. If the number of classes is n, you need a n-bit representation to represent the each class labels. So in this case, again, I'm going to construct a neural network architectures. It's not a CNN. It's a plain neural network architectures, which will have a fully connected layers alone. So the first hidden layer with 2,000 neuron, my input dimension is 3072. And for the output layer, the number of layer will be the 3, because it's a three-class problem, which is a multi-classification problem. The number of classes is 3, and activation function is a softmax. The one which we discussed, the last one, which is a binary class problem, the one now we are looking at, it's a multi-classification problem. So the first layer with the 2,000 neurons, hidden layer, input dimension is 3072. All these hidden layers are with the activations of ReLU, and the activation functions for the output layer will be the softmax. In earlier case, we used sigmoid as activation function for the binary classification. So once we create a model, then we have to go for a model.compile. The last one, we used a binary cross entropy. for the binary classification. In case of multi-classifications, we are using a categorical cross entropy, and optimization and the remaining parameters are same. And then we are just plotting what is the number of parameter for this particular use case. There will be a 82,47,403 number of parameters. So we should reduce the number of parameters basically. So in this case, there is a more number of parameters which are used by the hidden layers basically. So when you go for basically the convolution layer and max pooling layer, we'll try to reduce the spatial dimension before it goes to the fully connected layer. But here we are not using any convolutions or max pooling layer. So the spatial dimensions are maintained here, but when we use a CNN, we'll be reducing the spatial dimension when it goes to the hidden layer. So in this case, we are using the input data and then output variable and the batch size and the number of epochs. So in earlier case, I was using 50, but in this case, I have mentioned as the batch size as a 128. So you can keep changing this. These are the parameter where you can play around with the deep learning architectures. And in earlier case, I have not shown you the prediction of the test data. So once I train a model, I'll give some of the test sample, which is an unknown sample, where I'm trying to resize the test data into 32 cross 32. And then I need to flatten that into an 1D vector. And then it goes to the trained model. And the trained model will predict what classes it belongs to. So basically, it says that the given classes image is a pandas, basically. So the third variable, which is a 1, which represents the pandas. Any questions on this? Instead of applying to the binary classifications here, I have applied the multi-classification problem with respect to image, the one which I have used, which is a numerical data. So with respect to neural network, you can apply with the text data as well as the image, or it may be numerical data. Only the thing is with respect to text data, you have to convert the text into the numbers, and then you can feed that input to the neural networks. In this case, it's a balanced data. With respect to image, there is a concept called a data augmentation, where you can generate, you can apply image translation, where you can add a random noise, you can apply flipping, you can do image rotations, where you can generate a more number of sample with respect to data augmentation. So when your data is unbalanced, basically. So in this case, I have used a balanced data. Each classes has the 1,000 sample, totally 3,000 sample. But if your data is not balanced, then you can go for a data augmentation. So basically, unbalanced in the sense the number of sample for each classes. So in this case, I have used 1,000 sample for each category, which is a cat, dog, and pandas. So the if you don't use balanced data, there is a possibility of overfitting.
So you are giving the input size is a 32 by 32. So we are reducing the image. So then feature will be lost, right?
True. So there are. I have worked on 320 into 460. You can also work with the larger dimension. Mm-hmm. The problem is that the number of parameters, the complexity of your architectures will be very high. Okay. So most of the topmost deep learning architecture, which they use not more than 300. So the maximum resolution which they use will be the 260, 299 cross 299, and 213 dimensions. So not more than a longer dimension. You can also construct your own architectures, but the problem is that the computation complexity will be more.
Suppose if you want to take the HD images, HD video images,
mm-hmm.
So then it will be 1080p and all will be there, right?
Yes. The problem is that if you want to use any existing model with the HD images, it's not possible.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to convert that into the model which was trained on, then you have to do the model predictions. If it is HD images, you have to construct your own models.
Okay. So what is the architecture you are using here?
These are custom architectures. This is not the standard deep learning architecture. These are the simple deep learning architectures. So I'll be using some of the standard deep learning architectures for the transfer learning. So that time I'll explain about the trained model.
Okay.
Yes. It's a, images are pixels, right? So the pixel, it's a numerical value again.
Yeah, but,
So one thing.
The machine learning will also do the same trick, right? Instead of going for a deep learning.
To answer your question, the same Pima Indian data set I have applied with the logistic regression. I have applied with the SVM. So when I work with the neural networks, where I'll get the better results actually. So.
But I compared the raw scores and the you know time. Everything was similar. I did not see any improvements.
Maybe there may be in your case, but it's not always true.
Mm-hmm.
This is not always. So the more you get the results in case of deep learning will be more the data you have. So if you have a lesser data, you may not get the good results in case of deep learning.
Also, I have found white blur in the images will also, you know, impute the noise as well, right? How you
basically, what I have done basically, there is a rain sticks removal problems which I worked actually. What I did, there are some pre-processing you can apply into the image, then you can, it's a basic image processing based concept. Instead of feeding the raw data into the directly to the deep learning architectures, you can work on with some of the pre-processing technique and then you can feed that data.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I have the next question for you.
Hey, hi.
Can I ask?
Talking about this problem, I see you're not using max pooling, right? Is it because you don't
see, have as I said, I have not yet started with the CNN. I just started with the simple neural network. So I'll be going with the convolutional neural network. I just wanted to explain what exactly the convolutional neural network. Then I'll go back to the CNN architectures. These are the simple plain neural network. Yes.
Okay, I'll have the next question before someone.
Yes.
So, will you be also talking about how videos can be converted into the images before it feeds into the model?
There are some of the Git repository which is available in my Git. Maybe you can go through that.
Okay.
So, I'll not be basically for the training. Most of the deep learning architectures we'll be training it on the images. But for the video, you can retrieve the one by one the frame, and the each frame goes to the predicted models.
Yeah, but the game is that if we can have a frame selected after a few frames, because not always all the frames are so distinguished.
That you can go for a keyframe extraction. So that and all, I'm not going to talk about the keyframe extraction, but probably if you want, we can discuss it offline.
After that, okay, thanks.
The question with respect to him, when you work on the real-time video analytics, it's not necessary to feed your data into the model because it will be time-consuming. Because in each seconds we'll be getting almost 25 or 30 frames. It's not necessary to be given to the model to make a predictions. So especially for the inferencing or the model deployment, we can apply those concepts.
Is there any need to do feature engineering in case of neural network the way we do in gradient boosting or random forest?
Basically the deep learning in the sense we are trying to learn the weight vector. Yeah. Basically, so it's not a features. Basically, the weights are trying to distinguish between what is cat and what is dog and pandas. So that's what we call it. So basically, here the features. So I'll pause the questions. I'll move on to the next topic. The next one which I want to talk about the convolutional neural network. So basically, as I said, there is no feature extraction is happening. Just it's a plain neural network where it tries to perform the classifications alone. But here in CNN, what happens basically, we are trying to apply the convolutions and then followed by the pooling layer, and then it goes to the fully connected. What we have seen, the right part we have seen already, which is the hidden layer 1 and hidden layer 2 and the output layer. These two layers we have not seen yet. So we are going to discuss about what exactly happens with the convolution and the pooling layer. Then I'll take a simple example and then we'll try to show some demo on that. This is with respect to the binary classification, multi-classification. The next one with respect to the binary classification. And basically here we have a convolution and the pooling layer, two more layers introduced with respect to CNN. One is a convolution and pooling layer. Here we'll have any number of convolution layer and pooling layer, but the first convolution layer, first should be the convolution layer, then you can have a pooling layer. So pooling layer cannot be placed before the convolution. The first convolution has to start. Then you can keep having the pooling layer. And you can have a consecutive convolution layer, and then you can have a pooling layer. But the pooling layer cannot be placed before the convolutions. See, it will be each layer with each convolution layer as the activation functions. So as I said, already we know about what is hidden layer, but now we are going to learn what exactly happens with this convolution and the pooling layer. So basically, with respect to image convolution, in traditional approaches, if I want to detect any edges, or if I want to do some smoothening operation, or there is a concept called low-pass filter and high-pass filter, basically. So high-pass filter, what happens, basically, it identifies the edges and corners in the images, basically, right? There is a kernels called so Laplacian kernel, or Sobel kernel, or Prewitt kernel. There are different types of image convolution kernels are available. Those are defined kernel. Okay. So now what is the difference between the traditional image processing convolution operation and the deep learning based image convolution operation? So basically, what happens with respect to image convolution? Here we have an image. This is the image. The respective image, we have a pixel value. And if it is an image convolution, there are three things will be there: input images, the matrix, and then we'll have a smaller matrix, which is an odd dimension. Either it may be 3x3, or it may be 5x5, or 7x7. So why it is always odd? So basically, we'll take the center of this kernel, and then we'll fit the center of the kernels into the XY coordinate in the images. Basically here. So here I have a 3x3 kernel. If you look at here, this is the 3x3 kernel. This is my original images. Here, these 3x3 values are defined. But in case of with respect to deep learning, randomly initialize this filter value, and we are trying to learn this filter value, basically. These are the traditional image processing based deep learning, image processing based convolution operation. So there will be a dot product between the pixel value and the kernel value. If you look at here, each pixel will have a two value. One is the pixel intensity, and the other one is the kernel value. So there will be 9 values will be there. So you do a dot product, and the summed up value will be put onto the output matrix, basically. So when you do an image convolution, basically, we'll not be able to apply the image convolutions on the border of the pixels. If you look at here, when I fit onto the 0,0 pixels, I'll not be able to fit that 3x3 kernels, because it resides outside the boundary. The kernels reside outside the boundary. There is a concept called zero padding, basically. When we do an image convolution, if you want to maintain the input and output as the same dimension, we have to apply with the zero padding. So first I'll explain without zero padding, then I'll explain what is with zero padding. So you keep moving this kernel across all the pixels in the input images from the left to right till you reach the pixels in the last pixels in the images. Okay, this is what we call it as an image convolution. Okay, but with respect to a single channel, you'll be able to understand what exactly happening with the image convolutions, right? But in the real time, most of the data what we get will be the color images, where we'll have a 3 matrices. How does that image convolution works? So with respect to color images, we'll be having a 3 input matrix, red matrix, green matrix, and blue matrix. So instead of having a single kernel, 3x3, we'll be having a 3x3 kernel for red channel, green channel, and blue channel. So you fit that respective kernel and the dot product value. The summed up of all these 3 dot product value will be put onto the output matrix. So here I'll be having a 2 kernel, two set of filters. W0 and W1, each has the 3x3 into the third dimensions will be the input depth. The first will be the height and width of the filter, and the third dimension filter size will be the what is your input depth. So in my case, the input depth will be the 3, because there are 3 matrices are there, which is a red, green, and blue channel. So the kernels also has to have 3x3 into 3. There should be 3x3, 3x3 should be there. This is with respect to deep learning, actually. In deep learning, so basically, as I said, these convolutions are helping to extract the feature pattern, either edges or the corners in the images. I'll show you one simple example. So here I'm trying to change this filter value. So basically what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to apply the image gradient actually. So if you apply this kind of image gradient, so this is what the filters. So here the flattened regions are not considering. Only the corners and the edges are taken because it gives the more meaningful information than the full images. So these filters values are fixed actually. So what we are trying to learn this filter value through the deep learning architectures. Okay, so this is one kind of filter. Instead of having one kind of these features, we are trying to have a multiple such a features. Those features we are not defining. We are asking machine to extract such a multiple features. You only define how many such a filter you want. What should be the size of filter? No, that is not, because if you define that, then it is a basic image processing based undefined operations, right? So, that's what. And you will define what is the filter size, whether it's a 3 cross 3 or a 5 cross 5. So, in case of... There are two things with respect to image convolution. As I was talking about with zero padding and without zero padding. So in case of with zero padding, so we'll be padding with the zero of one zeros in the corner of the images. If your kernel size is 3 cross 3, there is a formula called amount of padding, P equal to F minus 1 divided by 2. F is the filter size, which is a 3. 3 minus 1 divided by 2, the p value will be the 1. So 1 zeros we need to pad in the corner of the images, basically. So where we'll be getting the input and output dimensions will be the same. But in this case, so here I'm having an input dimension is a 5 cross 5. This is my filter value. And the output dimensions will be the 3 cross 3. Because the first row and the last row and the first column and the last column, I will not be able to apply the image convolution. So the output dimensions will be the 3 cross 3. So if I want to maintain the dimension input and output, I have to go with the amount of padding. There is a term called padding is equal to valid and same. When we write a deep learning architectures, we need to define whether you go with the zero padding or without zero padding. Mm-hmm. See, you can also pad with some constant value, or you can also fill with the neighboring pixels, but most of them will go with the zero padding.
Any reason for that?
Most of the, recently I've worked with, there is a concept called a segment deep learning architecture, which is for the image segmentation. What happens, there is an encoder and a decoder network. Basically, in encoder network, what happens, it keeps reducing the spatial dimension. When they want to reconstruct the same input dimension, the pattern has to be maintained in a such a way that we can reconstruct the original dimensions. But that case, they have used with the zero padding. But I have not seen, apart from the zero padding, in the corner of the images. Maybe you can try with that, but I have not yet experimented. Maybe. So I'm maybe the problem you may get by unbiased.
Yeah.
So in this case, let's take a real world problem. So my data is 32 cross 32 into 3. This is my input dimension. I have a 1 3 cross 3 filter. So what will be my output dimensions? So there is a formula is there. So I'll come back to that formula. So if I apply one different filter, I'll get one 30 cross 30 as a feature map. So if I have a 30 different filter, I'll have a 30 different feature map. The depth will be the number of filters. Okay, the height and width will be the remain same for all the feature map, and the depth is going to be increased. So we can have any combination of filter, either 3x3 or 5x5 or 7x7. This is the height of the filter and width of the filter. What is the third dimension? What is your input depth? Whether input depth is a color, a single channel or a multi-channel. So based on the number of channel, you can define the input depth. And there is a fourth parameter. How many such a filters you want to apply? Whether two such a filters you need or 10 different such a filter you need, the fourth parameter will be the number of parameters. So this is called as the weight value for the first convolution layer. As I said, when we fit the kernels into the XY coordinate, the center of the kernels will be taking, right? So odd kernel will not having the center pixels, right? So that is the main reason people use with the kernels with the odd size. If you look at here, basically we are taking the center of the kernel and then we'll be fitting into the each XY coordinate. So if it is an odd size, there won't be any center pixels at all. So this is a simple animation. So how does that convolution works? Each pixel value follow the red one are filter value, and the green ones are basically the pixel value, and the dot product summed up value will be put onto the output matrix. So as I said, if it is a multiple such a filter, the depth will keep increasing. There will be multiple such a features we are trying to extract. So basically, how do I compute what will be the output dimensions from the convolution layer? So here n is the basically the height or width, and f is the filter size, p is the amount of zero padding, and s is the stride. What is meant by stride? Basically, first pixels I'm applying into this particular pixel. What is the next pixel I'm applying the convolution? Whether you are capturing the information in a overlapping manner or in a non-overlapping manner. So basically, most of the time we'll use with the overlapping manner because we are capturing the detailed informations. So if you use a stride value more than one, then you are losing some of the informations. So most of the, for the convolution layer, the stride value one will be the used approaches. And the filter value, you can ask why I'm choosing as a filter value three. Most of the research paper and most of the deep learning architectures, they use as a 3x3. 5x5, no, I have not seen most of the papers and the 7x7 at all. So here, let's assume that 32 minus f value is 3, 32 minus 3. Let's assume that the p value will be the 0 and the s value will be the 1 plus 1. So what value will get? 32 minus 3. So we'll get 29 by 1 plus 1. So 30 we'll get. So in this case, the height and width both are same dimension. So I'm computing only the one dimension. So what is the value I'm getting? If it is a 32 cross 32, what will be the output dimension, which is a 30 cross 30? Okay, so I want to go with zero padding, right? So now 32 minus 3, 29. So the p value will be the 1. F minus 1 divided by 2. So the p value will be the 1. So 29 plus 2, it will be the 31. 31 plus 1, it will be the 32. So the input and output dimensions both are same if you go for an with zero padding. So this is some of the feature visualization, what exactly the convolution layer. So this will be the one filter. So like this, we have a multiple such filters are there. So we have learned more detail about what exactly happening with the convolution layer. The next layer with respect to the deep learning architectures in case of CNN will be the pooling layer. Okay. So there are two kind of pooling layer. One is an average pooling layer and other one is a max pooling layer. So why again, there is a question, which one should I use? Okay, so most of the results show that when I use max pooling layer, we can also some of the layers people are even using with the average pooling as well. But most of the cases where we'll get a better results when we use a max pooling layer. Okay, so what is happening with the especially with the max pooling layer? With respect to convolution layer, what are the parameters? First, we should define what is the filter size, the number of filters, and the whether with zero padding or without zero padding, the p value and the stride. There are four parameters, right? So in the case of pooling layer, again, there is a two parameter. What is the filter size? In this case, we can have a filter size even odd or even. So there is no such a logic here, okay? So here we are, we'll be using as a filter size as a 2x2, and the stride value will be the 2. So if it is a stride value will be the 2, we are going in a non-overlapping manner. So first I'm fitting here. Basically the pooling layer, it does the pixel test basically. Whether within these four pixel, which one has the maximum one, Okay. So in earlier case, what we do, we'll have a filter value and the pixel value, we will do a dot product and the summed up value, right? So there is no such a concept here. Just you take all the pixels within the filter, and there are four pixels if it is a 2x2, and you identify which one has the maximum pixel. You put onto the output matrix. So then you move the filter into two style as a two. So now we'll have again there's a four more pixels, and you'll have the maximum value will be the 7. Similarly, you try to compute. So basically, if you go with the max pooling layer, the spatial dimensions will get reduced by the half of the dimensions. Okay. So if it is average pooling, instead of taking the maximum value, take the mean, sum up the all the pixels and take the mean value of it. So I'll take a simple note, the tracing of this deep learning architectures especially. So if it is a 32x32 images, there will be 1024 pixels will be there. And I'm going to take a 10 different filter, and each filters will be the 5x5. And there will be bias will be there. Totally, you will have a 26 parameter weight value. Right. So now, if I slide this 5x5 into the 32x32 images without zero padding, what will be the output dimension? 32 minus 5 plus 0 divided by 1. So 32 minus 5, it will be the 27 plus 1, 28. So if I apply 5x5 into 32x32, I'll get 128x28. If I apply 10 different filters, I'll get 10 different 28x28, which means if it is a 128x28, it will be a 784 pixel. If it is a 10 different 28x28, there will be a 7840 pixels. So now I'm going to the next layer, which is a pooling layer, where I'm going to apply the filter size of 2x2 with a stride of 2. So what is the basic thumb rule? Half of the spatial dimension will get reduced, right? So it is a basically 28x28, it will reduce into 14x14. So if it is a 14x14, there will be 10 different 14x14. So before I go into the fully connected layer, I have to flatten this 2D vector into 1D vector, which will have a 1960 values, right? So after this, I'll be having a 200 as a hidden layer neuron 1. So in this case, each neuron receives the connection of 1960. So there will be a 392,000 connections will be receiving by the 200 neurons. So you look at the number of parameter which is used by the hidden layer basically. Then from the 1960, we arrived at 200 neurons, right? Then you keep one more hidden layer with the number of classes. It may be 10 or it may be based on the number of classes. You will arrive at the output layer. Any questions before I move on to the hands-on for this? Activations, I'm not going into detail. So I'll be using ReLU activation functions across all the hidden layers.
Okay. The one more question regarding the activation function. The activation function will create the non-linearity.
Mm-hmm.
That means convolution is creating the linear function, linear output.
Basically, the non-linear when we do a dot product and the maximum value what we take from the ReLU mm-hmm. will be the non-linear. Basically, the activation functions, I have not gone into detail level of what exactly it is happening. Okay. But as per my knowledge, what in case of convolution layer, there will be a possibility of negative value as well.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
The filter value, there may be a possibility of negative as well. The summed up value, there may be a case where we'll have a negative value.
Mm-hmm.
So that value will be minimized into on zero.
You have taken average of here.
Yes.
You've taken average of the entire matrix after you did the max pooling, right?
Yes, yes.
Instead of that, you could have taken the average of the entire matrix itself, right? It would have been the same.
See, as I said, there you can use max pooling or average pooling. It's not, again, I'm saying this is not a constant approach. Again, you can play, this is another hyperparameter, whether I should use average pooling or whether I should use a max pooling. This is left to you. You can play around with the architectures, measure the precision and recall. Which one you get a better result, choose that.
No, when you took max pooling, you're taking the maximum of the four numbers that are there, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So that would be the same as taking the maximum number in the entire big matrix itself.
I didn't get your questions. Can you come again?
So in max pooling, mm-hmm. you got the 2x2 matrix.
Yes.
After that, you're saying you're taking one value of it, which is 9,
mm-hmm.
is the maximum.
Mm-hmm.
9 is the maximum even here.
See, basically, I'll explain it again. I don't know how you know. So basically, here I have a 4x4 matrix.
Yeah.
My filter size is 2x2. Correct. Within these 2x2, there is a sub-images. You assume it is a sub-images.
Okay.
And within these sub-images, what is the maximum pixel value, which is a 4, which is a 7. Again, I'm moving my filter into another sub-images, which has the pixel value of 9, the maximum value. You slide the kernel again down. So here, within these sub-images, the pixel value, which is a 8, and with this, the last sub-images, the maximum pixel value is 5.
And the entire 4x4 matrix has a maximum value of 9. So instead of going to the next next step, first
see,
step...
See, this is not a continuous...
No. I'm not looking at the average part of it.
Okay.
I'm just looking at the max pool part of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm saying that in the entire 4x4 matrix, mm-hmm. the maximum number is 9.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of going to the next step, in the first step only, we can decide that...
See, your question is, I understood. So if you look at with the single value, you
correct.
Lose some of the informations. So there are concepts called upsampling. We'll be using some of the use cases where I used upsampling.
Okay.
So where we'll try to reconstruct the original dimensions as well. So from if I reduce 2x2 or 8x8 or 10x10, after some time there may be a possibility some of the deep learning architectures we'll try to reconstruct. In such cases, with a single pixel value for the bigger matrix will not be possible.
Okay.
So you're saying that why can't I take only the 9 as a pixel value from the max pooling layer,
right?
Because
end of the day, you're taking that number alone.
See, the informations, you'll be losing the informations.
Okay.
Hello. I think there are two clear... Here, I'm here.
Yes.
I think there are two clear advantages with using 3x3, and that's why it got standardized across the field, right? One is we can get less parameters instead of convolving it 5x5, which you see in VGG or in AlexNet and all, they use 5x5. But after that, 3x3 got standardized because you get less parameters with the same receptive field. We can convolve 5x5 with 2x3x3, we get the same with less parameters, right? 3x3, 9 plus 9, 18. With 5x5, we have 25 parameters.
Yes, true. So it's again, it's not still the proof. But you can play around with the whatever you want actually. Still, there is no proof, right? So now I'll go back to the hands-on for this. Pixel value into 0 to 1. Then we are performing an 1-0 encoding vector. The difference between the plain neural network and the convolutional neural network is that we'll be starting the first layer as a convolution. In earlier case, we started with the dense, which is a fully connected layer or a hidden layer, right? So here we are starting with the convolution. First, I'm defining what is the number of filters and what is the kernel size and what activation function, and then I should define what is the input dimensions, right? So the next one also I'm defining with the convolution with the 64 filters and 3x3 as a filter size, and the next one, which is the pooling layer, there are some of the parameters which I have not mentioned at all. There are some of the default parameters are available for the functions. Case of padding, I have not mentioned. The default value will be the padding will be the valid. And the stride also I have not mentioned. The stride value will be the 1. Okay. Similarly, for the max pooling layer, the stride value, the default stride value will be the 2. So here, basically, there is a dropout which I have introduced here. For example, I have 100 connections, which carries from layer 1 to I to I plus 1. I'm mentioning 25% of the connections which has to be randomly removed. So I was talking about the regularization terms, right? Where there may be a possibility we'll get overfitting of our model, right? So in such cases where we can apply this kind of dropout layer or batch normalization layer, which can reduce the gap between the training loss and the validation loss will be the very huge. So in such cases, if you want to reduce the gap between the training and the validation loss, you can go for a dropout kind of stuff. So the last layer I'm defining with the number of classes. In this case, the 10 number of digits and the softmax activation function. Okay. So what is our here? You'll be able to get the what is the output dimensions from the each layer. What is our input? Which is a 28x28. How many such a filters we are using? 32 different filters, each filters with the 3x3. So what will be the output dimensions we'll get? 26x26, the third dimensions will be the 32. So how do I get this 320? Because what is the filter size? Which is a 3x3 into 32, plus the number bias value, which is a 32. So if you multiply all this thing, you will get the number of parameters which are required by the convolution. But in case of max pooling layer, there is no training parameters, because just we are doing the pixel test among the sub-images. The remaining things are same. So only the portion is that the construction of the architectures or creation of these deep learning architectures alone different. Is there any questions on this particular thing? Yes. Again, I'll tell you what are the parameters with respect to the CNN. The number of filters you can play around with, and then the kernel size you can play around. And there is a valid parameters. There is a padding is equal to valid or same. So those are the, and the stride also. So there are four parameters with respect to convolution. With respect to pooling layer, two parameters, filter size and the stride. Those are trainable parameters. You can play around with it.
How do you decide to go with?
Again, only the thumb rule is that first layer should start with the convolution. You can have a three consecutive convolution layer, then you can keep a pooling layer. But there is again, there is no logic behind it. You can have a five convolution, then you can have a pooling. Even you can have a one convolution and one pooling, so that is a different combinations you can create.
At the end, can I get a significance of which filter contributed the most to accuracy?
That what you can do, what I did basically, I downloaded the weight file into HPyFy, where I have used the HDFI viewer actually, so to analyze what exactly the weight values, how the weight values are. Personally, I wanted to inspect what exactly the weight values are. But till now, I have not analyzed the result with respect to layer by layer. I have not done. Okay. But you can visualize the features layer by layer. What features you are getting layer by layer, those you can visualize. But the impact on the final accuracy, I have not yet done.
Okay, thanks.
So I'll take one more example with respect to image classification. This is the Kegel dataset, which is a facial expression dataset. There are seven different emotions actually. So the each dimension, which is a 48 cross 48. So these are the sample images of different emotions. There are seven different emotions. And there are 28,709 records for the training data, 3,589 sample for the testing data. So similarly, I'm trying to perform the one-hot encoding vectors. And then I just randomly, I want to visualize some of the images of the data. And again, I'm creating a deep learning architectures here. The input shape, as I said, it may be CNN or it may be a plain neural network. We have a control of defining the input and the output number of neurons. In this case, there are seven different emotions. So the output number of neurons will be the seven. And the input dimension is my input image is 48 cross 48, so I'll be able to define that. So that is a fixed parameter. It depends on the what kind of data or what kind of use case which you are working on. That you can, again, you can use 100 cross 100 or 200 cross 200. There is one more use case. Recently I have participated in one hackathon, which is a Hintel hackathon. They have given an Indian driving data set for the autonomous vehicle. IIIT Hyderabad and Intel, they are working collaboratively to build autonomous vehicles. Is there a possibility in doing an R&D in India? They have captured a video of sample images in the Bangalore and the Hyderabad road scenario, where they have given the 320 cross 460 image dimension, where I created a model for it and I submitted. That I'll discuss next. You can have dimensions of different dimension with respect to the data or what kind of problems you are working on. So in this case, first layer convolution, and here I'll be using a batch normalization layer, and convolutions again, two convolution, three convolution, four convolution, and after that I'll be using a max pooling layer, and then the last layer with the seven number of neurons. So there is one more thing which I wanted to discuss here. When we train a deep learning model, there is a concept called model checkpoints. Okay. So what is the necessity of model checkpoint? Because I'll be giving the basically the number of epochs, maybe 1,000 or 500. there may be a, after 100 epochs, there won't be much changes in the performance, right? So it won't improve after some iterations, right? So will I have to train for, keep training 1,000 or n iterations? It's not necessary. So you can use some kind of model checkpoint. So you can save the model weights, and when there is a best compared to the basically the compared to the previous epoch, is there any improvement? Then you save the model into HPI. So there are two things: you can save a model, and you can also terminate the early checkpoint early of terminating the model training basically. And here, what happens? The model.fit, you can store this into some variable. When we train a model, the history of the log of the training value and the testing value of the loss and accuracy, I'll be storing into the variable of HAST. And using that variable, I'll be plotting using matplot library the loss of validation loss and the training loss, and similarly the accuracy. So if you look at here, this is the loss of the training with respect to the number of epochs, and this is the accuracy. So here, if you look at here, the accuracy was pretty low, right? So which is a 50%. So you can keep fine-tuning the number of filters and the filter size and the depth of the layer. You will be able to improvise this particular power accuracy, or there may be possibility to reduce as well. So once we train the model, I have just shown you the predicted value. This both the within these brackets are ground truth value. These are the model predicted value. If both are same, it will be shown in the green color. The remaining values are shown in the red colors. So these are the predicted value for the test data. Any questions with respect to this particular use case?
You spoke about the image compression when we use that. So what sort of technology is that? It's like image? A max. When we use the image compression, so what type of technology is used, max or average, the pooling thing?
Here, most of the cases, what I'm using, I have came across, there is an Inception V3, where they have used max pooling layer, where you'll work with the more number of layers, right? In such cases, to reduce the spatial dimensions, where they have used average pooling.
Yes.
So, but the one which I've used, the smaller number of, the depth of the layers are very less, where I have used max pooling. But I have not applied average pooling over here. Okay. So all these are max pooling alone.
Okay.
But you can also apply with the average pooling, but there will be a reduction in the performance.
Okay.
Compared to max pooling, if you apply with the average pooling for the same use case, there will be a performance degradation.
Okay.
So for the same CNN, I'll start with the transfer learning. I was talking about the transfer learning. So these are some of the deep learning architectures. This is done by myself. Actually, I wrote a research paper where I wanted to analyze the different pre-trained model for my own use cases. You can go through my Google Scholar, which I have published in Computer Vision Conference. So these are some of the pre-trained model which I have taken in 2016, actually. At the time, there was a 5 pre-trained model, but now we have a 10 plus pre-trained model, for especially for the CNN. So where basically what happens with respect to the pre-trained model, when you don't have a proper data set, the number of sample for each category, it's very less. In such cases, where I can go for a pre-trained model, and if you don't have a GPU machine, in such cases, quickly if you want to build any prototype for your particular use cases, you can go with the pre-trained model. I'll take one of the pre-trained model from here, and I'll show you how it works. So what is exactly the transfer learning or the pre-trained model? So basically what we did till now, we create a deep learning architecture, CNN, or it may be a plain neural network, and we train a model from the first layer till the last layer. So what exactly the pre-trained model says that, we have seen some of these deep learning architectures, there are weights are already open source, it is available. All these trained model weights are available in a HPI5 format. So what I'm going to do, I'm not going to consider till the last layer, because if I consider till the last layer with respect to their applications, but if I with respect to my own application, the output layer has to be changed. What I'm going to do, I'm going to remove the last few layers in the existing trained model architectures, and you act the this existing trained model as a features. Okay, so what I'm trying to say, so these are the pre-trained model. So I'm not taking the full, the last layer. You consider this as a VGG or a ResNet or maybe a inception or maybe a exception or whatever architectures. I removed the last few layer. Before the last few layers, what are the intermediate results which comes out of the pre-trained model? I consider as a features. These are not hand-defined features. These are machine-learned features. Like whatever the traditional texture features or a color features or maybe a statistical features, those are undefined features. But whatever here we are applying with the deep learning features. So now, instead of training a deep learning architecture end to end, so we are going to train only these few two layers alone. So these are already extracted features close to the input to the neural network. So what happens basically, the left side part already the existing trained models are available. By removing the few layers, I consider this the pre-trained model as a feature extraction, and then I construct my own number of hidden layers at the output layer, and you train only this, the left side portions alone, and then probably you'll get a good results. So what happens, what I did basically, there is a bird classifications which I built. There is a unbalanced problem with respect to the data. So I have more number of sample for the not bird category. For the bird category, I have a very less data. If I build a model for that particular from the scratch, I'm not getting a good results. Machine has the better understanding on the not bird category than the bird category. So if you measure the precision and recall, you'll be able to know what exactly they happen. If I go for the same data, even if I have 100 sample or 1,000 sample for each category, the accuracy will be both bird and not bird will be the equal level. Okay. So I'll take a simple example with respect to transfer learning. So with respect to deep learning, so what deep learning architectures you have to use? I'm mentioning the exception deep learning architectures which I want to use. And so whether you have to consider this deep learning architecture still the last layer, or you are not including the last layer, that I have to mention. What weights you want to use? There are Kitty dataset, ImageNet dataset, there are plenty of pre-trained model weights are available. So here I'm mentioning what weights, pre-trained model weights I should consider, and whether I should consider the last layer or not. So here I'm removing the last layer. Before the last layer, I'm trying to extract the features. You can also mention from which layer, the name of the layer also you can mention, from where you can extract the feature from that. So now what I'm trying to do, so I'm feeding all the data. Here I'm having the bird and not bird category. From the Git, I'm cloned that particular data, which has the bird and not bird data. So for that, I'm feeding all these into the pre-trained model, the exception pre-trained model, that I'm considering as a features, where I have stored those features. And then I have saved into a .dot file, and then I'm trying to construct a neural network architectures. For these neural network architectures, what dimension of the what is the shape of the feature which you have extracted, whether 1,084 as a feature from the pre-trained model or 1,000. The last layer, the dimensions of the last layer will be the input to the neural network. So in this case, the input dimensions will be the output of the pre-trained model feature shape. Then I'm constructing the hidden layer and the output layer. So only these portions I'm going to train. The one which I've showed, the feature extraction, this is the pre-trained model. So once we train the model, we'll be able to get the classifications report and the confusion matrix as well. So in this case, the confusion matrix, true positive, which both actual and the predicted, if both are same, that will be the true positive. And the true negative, in the sense not bird as classified as a not bird, will be the true negative. Bird are false positive and the false negative. So you can get the true negative, true positive, false negative and false positive. With that, you will be able to compute the precision and recall as well. So any, so you can also apply, not even for the bird, the data which I've used, even you can use the same model weights for any kind of, even for the face recognition you can use, or any kind of related to image data, you can use this pre-trained model weight. Because the data which was trained on the ImageNet data set. For example, some of the people who works on the autonomous vehicle, those cases there is a data set called Kitty data set with respect to the navigation of the road scenario. Those weights you can consider with respect to the use case, the business problem, you can consider the respective the model. Main problem with the industry is that what happens, most of the business problem, what happened, we will not have a data set. Even if we have a data, that won't be improper. So it may be unstructured data or maybe a noisy data. In such cases, most of the time, what happens is we spend more time on generating the data. Or so instead of quickly, if you want to show to the customer or if you want to do some POC kind of stuff, you can go with the transfer learning.
No, that is, we can use the pre-trained. Means we are asking about the transfer learning.
See, transfer learning is a pre-trained model only.
No. Pre-trained model, so if we want to add some new feature that we can use for the transfer learning, right?
See, basically what I said, the transfer learning in the sense, you take a pre-trained model and you remove the few layers and that you consider as a features.
Okay.
This will be the, because that the pre-trained models are designed for their own purpose. Maybe 100,000 classes or maybe 100 classes. But my class, the number of classes will vary, right?
Yeah.
So I'm constructing a one or two more layer based on the business use case.
So that is called transfer learning.
Yes.
Yeah, that's what, if you want to add new features or if you want to
it's
train for the
feature,
new.
Feature basically.
If you want to add a new classifications,
yes.
Or you want to add
for the
new
custom
data
problem.
Okay.
For the custom use cases, you can create this right side portion alone.
Okay. You want to customize the existing pre-trained model. We can that time also you can use the transfer learning, right?
See, basically one more thing with the pre-trained model is that if you want to use a pre-trained model, your image size has to be resized into the particular dimensions to fit into the pre-trained model. There are problem what I faced actually when I want to use a pre-trained model for the data set, which was a different dimensions. When I feed that data, the feature map concatenations generates some issues basically. There are architectures called residual network. It skips the connections from the one layer to the few layers where there is a feature concatenations will happen. In such cases, pre-trained model, if it is a different dimensions, it won't work. Yes.
Does it make sense to actually resize it, or can we use something like max pooling before that image?
What happens in some of the use cases, I use resizing. There is a lambda functions which I used actually in TensorFlow. There is a lambda functions to fill the pixel value. So these are the two ways what I use actually. One second. For which use case?
The last program which you showed.
Yes. For the bird category, which is a 86, sorry, not bird 86, and the bird category, which is a 78.
Right. So, how to means after this, we should consider this as a base and then go and improve the model.
Basically, you can change the other pre-trained model. Here, I have used the exception pre-trained model.
Right.
You can go for a dense net. Nowadays, there are plenty of other models. Mobile net is there.
Okay.
So again, one more thing is that which pre-trained model should I use?
To start
because most of the deployment will happen on without GPU, right? In such cases, the computational complexity also you need to consider.
Okay.
So there is a squeeze net is available for the lightweight. You can use a mobile net. So that there is a tabular representation. Let me show you that. So these are the pre-trained model which are available basically. So now, how do I consider which pre-trained model should I use? Whether you are bothered about the accuracy, whether you are bothered about which deployment you are going to deploy the model. So I'm going to deploy my model into the mobile, or I'm going to deploy into the edge hardware or the low spec hardware. I should consider where the number of parameters are very less. So the mobile nets are very less in case of the number of parameter, mobile net V2. But if I'm bothered about the accuracy, then I should choose the NASA net large. So you have to decide whether your applications it's going to run on the cloud or it is on the edge. Yes, it's.
How do you handle like a 3D face anti-spoofing?
I have not worked with respect to 3D data, but I have worked with the 3D CNN. There is a concept called a 3D CNN, which I have worked for the video data. So I've done some of the use cases for the video analytics, whether the if there is some suspicious activity is happening, somebody is doing some shoplifting, or somebody with a gun, or somebody is fighting. So if whatever we worked with, which is a spatial data, so whatever you are, which is a temporal data. So instead of doing a classification with a single frame, I should consider the contiguous n frame, then I'll make a decision. But 3D images I have not worked, but I have worked with the video data.
But how, even though video data, mm-hmm. when you consider like
so basically instead of 2D filter, we'll have a 3D filters.
No,
so
you cannot, the question here is, you cannot define the frame as a fixed size because your noise or maybe your gesture, whatever the pose, whatever you will take,
mm-hmm.
your frame size may differ. Why? Because when you take a 3D image, mm-hmm. there is a depth matrix
mm-hmm.
which comes to is a movable depth matrix, mm-hmm. where here it is a fixed depth matrix.
Mm-hmm.
You can freeze.
So whatever I was talking about, which is a color image, is RGB data. But what
RGB is a depth. But what happened, the RGB color with the depth matrix as a vector, which will get a one dimension, and it's a movable.
Maybe. I have not explored on such use cases. Maybe. But
I heard that one of the algorithm is known as ICP,
mm-hmm.
where it ICP and FaceNet.
Okay, so even for the some of the synthetic 3D models
yeah,
are
yeah.
there.
Synthesizing
actually.
Of 3D model.
Yes, yes. I have seen the research papers, okay. but I have not really.
It's IEEE
I have not,
paper. Yeah.
I have not really worked on to the 3D image data, but I have worked on the image and video related data. So good questions. He was pointed about. I just wanted to recall about. We have discussed about the 2D images, but what happens if it is an image? There is a concept called a 3D CNN. So instead of having a 2D filter, we'll have a 3D filters basically based on the number of frames and the each height and width of the filters.
Hi.
I'll Here. Stop now. Maybe I need to. I'll pause after some time. I'll take. I need to explain one more use case, the logic. Then I'll come back. So we have discussed about what is meant by classification with respect to object detections, right? So what happens if there is a multiple objects are within a single image? So in this case, let's assume that there is a cat and dog as well. So how your model will do a classification? You can go with the multi-labeling. You can do a multi-labeling, then your model can build. But which location there is a cat or there is which location there is a dog? Will your model will give you the classification? It will say it is a cat dog, right? So it will not give you the location exactly where my dog is present, right? So basically what is meant by in case of object detection, it is a combination of classification plus localization. Localization in the sense it will give you the bounding box label additionally with respect to the classifications. So these are the survey of what exactly the research happens with respect to the deep learning. So the before deep learning, it was a hand defined, there is a Viola-Jones algorithm. There is a histogram of oriented gradient if you want to perform any object till 2012-13. So these are the most used research paper with respect to object detection. When the deep learning started, the accuracy was keep increasing. There is a fast RCNN, faster RCNN, SSD, YOLO, and the retina net. There are multiple deep learning architectures with respect to the object detections. So basically, what is meant by basically the object detection? We'll take a smaller window. Sorry, the animation was not working. So you take a smaller window, you take that as a sub-images and you give it to the classification model. But with respect to classification, we'll take a whole image and then we feed into the deep learning architecture. So here what basically we are trying to do, traditionally there is a sliding window where the constant window of m cross n size, and then they'll keep moving the sliding window. And when there is a target image is found at that particular location, then we'll be detecting as an object is found. So if you look at here, in earlier scenario, what happens basically, we'll take these full images and we feed into the deep learning, and the deep learning will say whether cat or not. But classification, what it does, it takes the sub-images and then it feed the into the model. There will be a multiple sub-images. It goes to the deep learning architectures and the deep learning model will classify it is a cat or dog or not. So basically, the complexity is that instead of moving across the window in all the location, can I find the n number of bounding box regions? So there is an approach called a selective search, which uses the basic computer vision features to identify the constant number of bounding boxes, which is probably a target object, which is in foreground. So instead of taking the constant number of bounding boxes, it identifies some bounding boxes and then use these bounding boxes to classify whether it's a cat or not. So I was talking about some of the existing object detection model, which is a hog and hare cascade. So with respect to hog, which uses the gradient descent, basically it computes the gradient magnitude. There is a Sobel operator. So you try to do the convolutions on the two directional, x directional and y directional. And I is the input images, dx is the dx kernel and dy kernel, and you sum up these two gx and gy and take a square root, which will be the magnitude value, and we are computing the theta. Theta will say that in which direction the pixel intensities are changing. So once we have this magnitude value, and then we will be dividing the magnitude value into cells, and from the cells we are computing a histogram. So what happens once you compute a histogram? It forms the block which has the 2 cross 2 in an overlapping manner. So basically once you have these HOG feature, basically what is the beauty of this HOG feature is that you pass any input images, it gives the structural shape of the object. So with respect to object detection or any kind of use cases, this was pretty good before deep learning. But nowadays it was not used much. But when I started my PhD with the research for object detection, I started with this and I went detail of understanding what exactly how it works. So the slides which I've used. So with respect to deep learning, what is the difference between the traditional approaches and the deep learning approaches? Basically, this particular pre-trained model was the deep learning approaches. With respect to RCNN architectures, the remainings are, it is not a completely, so instead of going into the, if I go back to this particular architecture, there are multiple patches are there. Each patch goes to the, independently, it goes to the deep learning architectures. So it is a computationally expensive. Because instead of applying a single image, it goes to the multiple patch, each patch computationally expensive. So to avoid this, the author came up with the new logic called as a fast RCNN. So they apply once the CNN model. On top of that, they are identifying the constant bounding boxes, and then they classify whether there is a target object present or not. There is a one more deep learning architecture, which is a SSD mobile SSD architectures. What happens basically, this is the pre-trained model, which is a backend. We'll say all these object detection, they use a pre-trained model as a backend. Either you can use VGG, or you can use mobile net, or you can use Inception, or anything. But the author which they have used VGG16 till the convolution 5 layer, they used as a feature map. And then they constructed the feature pyramid. Basically, this will, when compared to yellow and mobile net, basically SSD, detect the smaller scale as well. But yellow, what happens, there are possibility of missing the smaller scale object. But it performs pretty good with respect to yellow. So the coming back to this, the last object detection, basically the YOLO, basically it divides the images into grids, and each grid will try to fix the anchor boxes. What is mean by anchor boxes? Because in this case, all the objects will have, each object will have a different shape. So if I have a one shape of bounding boxes, I should have a different shapes of bounding boxes, which is called as a anchor boxes. So you try to fit the anchor boxes into the each grid, and you try to predict whether there is a target object which is present or not. In YOLO, there are YOLO V2, V3, tiny YOLO. So I have come up with my own tiny YOLO. So I have worked for the Boeing customer, where they wanted to basically some of the use cases which they have worked on. So where they wanted to deploy the model into the flight, basically, where that such cases there is no GPU enabled devices within to that particular cases, where I have to optimize the still the number of parameter with respect to the deep learning architectures. So now I am coming back to the last use cases, which is the image segmentation. There is a two kind of segmentation. One is a semantic segmentation and the other one is an instance segmentation. But I'll restrict into semantic segmentations. I'm not going into detail of what is instance segmentation. So basically what happens with respect to semantic segmentation, this I have done some of the POC in my previous organization. Basically there is a research paper called Segnet, which was done by the Cambridge University. One of the postdoc student has done the model. They have created a cam video data set, which has the 11 classes, basically, lane, car, road, trees, building, fence, person, cycle. So like that, they have created a basically 11 classes. This is the model which I have created. This is the deep learning architectures with respect to the segmentation. Basically, here we'll have an encoder network. Encoder network which keeps reducing the feature dimension. But here, wherever I place the green color, which are called as a max pooling, where I have all these red are will be considering as a upsampling. There is a layer called upsampling, where we'll be reconstructing the all these dimension. Wherever we had a convolution, there is a deconvolution. And then finally, what happens, the final layer, what will be the final layer with respect to image segmentation? Basically, for each pixel by pixel, we have to perform a classification. But we have learned about how we do image classification at the whole picture level. But with respect to segmentation, I need to classify each pixel by pixel. And whatever I'm showing here, this is the, I have a predefined color value for all the classes. The predicted pixel is whether road or whether it's a tree. I'm mapping that predicted classes into the color map value. So whatever here you are seeing, it is a color map value. So I'll show you one use cases which have worked as a part of a hackathon, which is an Indian road driving scenario. This is a data set which was given by the these are the some of the sample which they have given. So I'll go back to Colab for that particular Indian driving data set. I have created a notebook file. So with that, I'll show you how we can create a semantic segmentation for that particular use case. So in this case, there are classes which they have defined, drivable, non-drivable, living things, vehicle, and this is the unknown objects which they have considered the last classes. So basically, this for this particular data set, this is the basically the ground truth value. Basically, the ground truth value, they'll be giving us a numerical value, whether it's a 0 or 1 or 2. So with based on that, we'll be mapping that into a particular color, basically. So here, I'll just show you the deep learning architectures. So as I said, there are two parts. One is the encoding layer. This is the encoding layer. The other one is the decoding layer. So wherever I had basically the max pooling layer, I'll be using upsampling layer in case of decoding. Similar to that, but here I'll be using a zero padding separately because I don't want to lose any information. So I'm applying a zero padding. Then I'm using a convolution and followed by a pooling. So here I have used four different convolution layer at the encoder. Similarly, I have used four different convolution layer at the decoder. Wherever I have used a max pooling, I've replaced with the upsampling layer. And in this case, the input dimension is 227 x 320. So what I faced, actually, I was trying to use some of the pre-trained model in this case, but I was not able to use because the input dimension, which is not at all fitting into the pre-trained model, there was a feature concatenation. Some of the layer was not allowing me to use the. So what I did, I constructed architectures and trained a model from the scratch itself. So basically, what will be the output layer for this particular kind of use cases? What will be the output layer? So I'll show you the tabular representation. So basically, in this case, the output layer should have 72640. So into 8, what is that 72640? So what is my input dimension in this case? If you multiply 227 into 320 into 3, there will be those many pixels will be there. For each pixels, how many probability I'll be getting? There will be 8 probability I'll be getting. And out of that, which one has the maximum value? Because for each pixel, we'll be getting a 8 value. Because there are 8 classes with respect to my use cases. Because with respect to use cases, the output layer will get vary. So we have learned about CNN classification. We have learned about how we can define for the segmentation use cases. That's it. Then what I did actually, once my model is trained, then I was feeding the test data. And once I get the test data, I was downloading the predictions for the test data. Then I was submitted that. So this is the part of some of the hackathons I was participated actually. So now I can take for a questions actually, if you have any questions.
Can you use other models, like you use Segment?
You can use, there is a UNET architectures. UNET. So there is a deep lab V3. So these are the famous deep learning architectures for the semantic segmentations.
Yeah. UNET and?
Deep Lab V3. Yeah. There are other architectures as well, but most of the accuracy results you will get with the UNET.
You applied the pre-trained model on the previous data sets.
But here I didn't use any pre-trained model.
So we can use U-train and other models.
The problem is that because here the dimensions of input is that I cannot resize. Because if I do resize, the prediction also, it will be resized, right? So it will not match with the ground truth what they expected. So I don't want to resize into some other dimensions. I don't want to use into their own models.
One more, like in the last data set, you have unbalanced data set.
Mm-hmm.
So you use pre-trained models.
Mm-hmm. See, if you use that case, you will get 1,000 classes of probability not for your own business problem. Because they were trained on the 1,000 different visual category of images, you will not get for your own use cases. You can do that. If your classes of problem already exist in that particular data set, you can use that. So what I did actually, some of the use cases, my intention is to detect the car and the two-wheeler. I was working on the smart parking project. So what I did, I didn't retrain my model. Even I didn't do the transfer learning at all. There is a data set already, model was trained actually. There is a COCO data set, which was already trained on those particular objects. So I was doing the class filtering alone. So I'm just checking whether it belongs to my classes. Then put a bounding boxes, else don't put a bounding boxes. So you can also use the existing pre-trained model as well. If the already your class, it belongs to that particular data set.
What if in the data set, in pre-trained models, there are certain number of classes
mm-hmm.
already.
Mm-hmm.
In our data set, we have a separate class, which is already not there
So then there is no point of using that pre-trained model.
You can use, still you can use, but come, we have to change some of the value at the last layer. Maybe I don't have a time. There is a YouTube video in my YouTube channel. I have done the Google Colab for the YOLO, how you can create a custom data set, how you can create. It is available in my... Yes, yes. You can still you can do a transfer learning for the object detection. There are certain parameters has to be changed in the configuration file. That's what I'm saying with respect to YOLO. There is a last layer should be the there is a logic called the number of filters and the number of objects, and there is a based on that logic we have to change those parameters. So maybe we can discuss offline. I have not taken those parts, so I don't want to. Take now. So if you want more detail, there is a half an hour video which I have created separately in my YouTube channel. It is available how you can create a custom data with respect to pre-trained model for the I have not taken object detection Anson here. There are 2-3 Git repositories are already available in my Git. You can use for the helmet and vest detections we have created some of the use cases for the safety measurement, but those data are not available with the existing data. So I created a custom data set from my own industry and we trained a model actually. That ID, Mohanraj, we you can put with the Google Colab. One second, okay. let me pause once. This is the basically the YouTube tutorial which I have written. YOLO object detection basically. You can go through this particularly. Every steps are given basically. You can go. Yes, I have mentioned each parameter what has to be done based on the number of classes. Everything it is written. So you can use there is a darknet repository for the YOLO. You have to clone and every steps are given. And you can clone and you have to compile the library and then you can use the YOLO V2 you want to use or YOLO V3 or you want to use a tiny YOLO. Based on that, you have to take that particular configuration file.
What exactly is the difference between image segmentation and detection?
Basically in image...
It's not the same, right?
Basically, instant segmentation, what happens in instant segmentation, I'll show you one more thing. I didn't get time to talk about more actually.
Okay.
So what happens here, the difference is that it's an instant segmentation, so I have not yet talked actually.
Okay.
So what additionally it gives basically, it performs classification, it performs detection, it performs segmentation. So it segmentation, it extracts the coordinates of the object for this particular object. So extract the boundary region, because when you put a bounding boxes, there are non-object pixel coordinates also there, right?
Yes.
So it's basically an instant segment. There is the architecture is called mask RCNN.
Okay.
Which was most famous for the instant segmentations where you can use those deep learning architectures.
And in detection, you're just doing edge detection mainly to...
No, I was talking about there is a YOLO, there is a SSD, there is a faster RCNN.
Okay, that is for...
detection.
Detection, okay.
So you can also use, there is a retina net is here, there are plenty of architectures are there. But most used will be the faster RCNN if you have a huge computation. And if you don't have a huge computations, then you have to go with the YOLO for the real time.
In the videos,
basically YOLO, the frames per seconds processing will be the real time actually. If you go with the faster RCNN, you will not get the maybe 1 or 2 FPS you will get. But in case of YOLO, you will get a 20 or 25 FPS you will get. yellow is. And also, if you have a huge computation power, then you can use a faster RCN in itself. Because there are, we use a GCP instance where we have a 2 GPU, 3 GPU we use to configure, and where we have a huge computation, even for the deployment you can use. Depends whether your model is running on the cloud or whether it's running on the edge itself. If it is a, there is a, I work on the Jetson Nano and Jetson TX2, which is for the deployment, some of the use cases, in even which has the GPU, but the not number of cores are not like high. So it's a limited number of cores are available, but still you have a GPU power. Actually, YOLO V3, it's actually what happens, it performs on the 3 scale actually. YOLO V2, V3, and there are, but if you go with the V3 again, the computations will be little high.
Yeah,
that's what, again, it depends on the what computation. YOLO V2 is little bit computation less when compared to the V3. The number of layers are very high. V3, right? V3, yes. Yes, because of it performs the detection on the 3 scales.
If we have to go real time for segmentation, so we have
I have not worked on instant segmentation, but I have worked on the deep of semantic segmentation.
Yeah, semantic segmentation for real time, we can have deep lab.
But I have not, sorry, I have not worked on the instant segmentation.
Hello. Yeah, I have a couple of questions.
Yes.
One was about transfer learning. Mm-hmm. What I have struggled is that when you have some complicated like ResNet or exception,
mm-hmm.
and these guys are built with units,
mm-hmm.
and then when you want to skip, so last layer is fine, but if
mm-hmm.
I want to skip a few layers,
mm-hmm.
I actually have to like go through and count, you know, where exactly, I cannot just put 5 or 6, like in VCC16 or VGG16, it's kind of simpler.
Mm-hmm.
So is there a cheat sheet or an easy way to identify, you know, how many, you know, kind of skip to the back?
That left to you actually, till which layer you want to consider, but that I cannot define whether you are considering till the 100 layer or 50 layer, that you can, we cannot, I cannot answer for these questions basically.
Okay. So because what I have seen with ResNet is they have this interconnections between layers.
Skip connections,
right?
Basically,
and you don't want to break it between the skip connections. You want to either go this side or that side. So what I have seen is I find voucher counting.
Because between the residual connections, skip connections, you cannot. That is a logic actually.
Okay. And the other thing was what at least I have experienced is certain, you know, fancy networks or the more complicated networks, they have good implementation in a specific framework, like maybe PyTorch or like fast RCNN has a specific implementation which everybody tends to use.
Mm-hmm.
And if you are a person who just knows TensorFlow, let us say,
mm-hmm.
Maybe you don't have that good implementations. So in such cases, what should a ML practitioner do? You should be able to switch to new frameworks and just adopt what is the best in the market, or maybe sit down and try and write your own implementation or for such things.
But as of now, actually, most of the research papers are comes with the, recently I've read a blog. Most of the research papers comes with the PyTorch actually. I have read a study actually. But most of the industry side, it's very less used on the PyTorch actually. But again, both are leading equally actually. But I have not, still I have not yet started with the PyTorch actually. Still we are with the TensorFlow. Because some of the cases where NVIDIA, most of the frameworks which supports on the TensorFlow, now they have, even they are working with the PyTorch as well. But more supports, I have not worked with the TensorFlow, but I have not known about PyTorch actually. It's again, but people are saying that who started working with the PyTorch, they feel more comfortable actually.
Yeah, it's challenging for like newcomers because, you know, spend some time learning something and then again you have a problem where you know that the best implementation is some other framework and then you again start and set up things. So
sorry, this question, it's I cannot. It's left to you which framework you feel comfortable, go with that. Whether it fits your requirement, then go ahead with
that. So the question was that is it a good choice to change the framework or just adapt the best implementation in whatever framework is available, or maybe, you know, wait or write your own implementation in the framework of your choice?
As of my knowledge, I prefer with the TensorFlow actually. Most of the updates and everything comes more on the TensorFlow and the supports and the documentations, whatever, I feel more comfortable with the TensorFlow.
Hello.
I use TensorFlow.
Hi. So my question is related to transfer learning.
Mm-hmm.
So in case of transfer learning, I mean, what happened, like mostly if we have a very less data, mm-hmm. which like we use,
mm-hmm.
So we did not get a good performance. So mm-hmm. is there any limitation or something? Is there limitation in the sense it's defined like this much of the images you should have it to customize the pre-trained model in case of transfer
even
learning?
Even I worked with the 20-30 samples for classes itself, even transfer learning works pretty good.
So you mean to say just 30-40 new images will give a good result?
Yes.
In case of transfer learning. Okay. Another question I have is what do you prefer?
In that case, if you feel less number of sample, you can go with the data augmentation. Flip your images, add a noise and rotations. So those approaches you can use, you can generate plenty of samples. Even one with that, you can generate 30-40 samples.
Right. So another question is, what do you think? I mean, obviously, this YOLO and all R has been framework as very complicated framework, right? And pre-trained models has been already trained on millions of images.
Mm-hmm.
What do you suggest if I'm working on a problem of object detection? Should I go and use the pre-trained model and then customize it? Or do you think that collect like more images and build your own network? So how do you suggest on that?
Still now I didn't create my own architecture for the object detection. I use the TensorFlow object detection API or I use YOLO. So the problem is that with all these has to be resized your images into that particular dimensions actually. If you want to create your own, do that. But
I mean, see, so there is a challenge in
the problem
your
is
own.
That annotation is the one more problem.
Yes.
Because we have almost three people always, we give the task to the people whenever. Still, we do a transfer learning. We need at least 1,000 or 2,000 or 3,000 of samples, right? So we ask the people, some of the guy help me to do annotations. And still, some people may not do the annotation properly. We have to guide them manually in such a way that it's localized properly, the annotations and all.
Right, and also the competition is also a problem. I mean, if you want to build your own network, you obviously you need to have a complex network, and then if you want to train. So data annotation is one part. Let's say if you have a data, but after that you need to have a computation power as well to do that.
Obviously you have to go with the GCP machines or either AWS with the CUDA computations actually. Mm-hmm. Else, actually what happens, one use cases, what we work on the some of the use cases, 12,000 iteration on the i7 machine with 32 GB RAM, 12,000 iteration went for 3 days. But in GCP, with the Tesla P100 or I'm not sure exactly, within 1 hour, 20,000 iteration is completed.
Okay.
So that's what the pretty much faster when you use the more high-end GPU machines.
Okay. And what is your opinion on the cognitive services provided by the clouds? I mean,
Whether my organizations prefer using GCP because security policies. Depends on the organization. Some company they prefer using AWS or some company prefer GCP. So that is left to the industry standards.
No, I'm not asking which cloud to use, mm-hmm. but what I have observed is like one of my colleague, he used the pre-trained model,
mm-hmm.
and then he customized it,
mm-hmm.
using transfer learning.
Mm-hmm.
The results were not good.
Mm-hmm.
And second, the same sample data, 30-40 images, we use in cognitive services,
okay.
Of Azure, and then we were able to get very good results. So
maybe there is a possibility of you can go with the ensemble of pre-trained model. Actually, what I did, I wrote one more Git repository. I shown you only with the single pre-trained model. You can also, that's what the reason what actually we do some research on all the pre-trained model for the respective data set and measure the performance, and then you choose the best model. You don't choose any one model and it may not suit actually.
Okay.
So you have to do some of the analysis on the 3-4 models on the existing model, and then you measure the performance, and then you go with the 1 or 2 combination or 3 combinations.
Okay.
But again, the computation will increase.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
Git repository ensemble of CNN. You can refer that.
Okay, sure. Thank you.
time is up or? Okay.
Is there any change in the image brightness?
Mm-hmm.
Whether we need to augment it or we can train the model with the brightness images.
So the thing is that with respect to deep learning, you collect your data on the different scenario, which means the low lighting and the proper lighting, and that's what the reason actually what we do, instead of the same data, we won't collect on the single day. So we collect on the different days and different lighting conditions, we switch off and we switch on, and that's where we generate more data.
So whether we can collect the data or we can augment the data using...
But augmentation, I'm not sure how much the performance will improve,
okay.
But more try to collect on the real time. See, basically, most of the people, what they do, they take the pre-trained model and they deploy onto the particular environment, but it may not work well at all. So we have to go into the respective environment and you collect the data and then you keep add along with the open source and then you retrain the model and then you deploy it.
Okay.
That's where your performance will improve. If you don't add your data, your own data into the existing data set, it will not work.
Okay.
Thank you guys.